Hi all, welcome to module P1. In this module, which is the first practical module, we'll be understanding how we can run our own simple web server, and this will be running on our own computer. So let's quickly recap what we've learned so far through module 1, 2, 3, and 4. We've sort of understood what clients and servers are. We've also understood that if we have a server's IP, or if we have a domain name that translates into the server's IP, we can make a request to the server. Then if the server makes a response in a format that our browser can understand, which was say an HTML format or a PNG image or a text file, then our browser can display the result. We've also had a brief introduction into what IPs and ports are. Our aim in this module is to install and deploy a simple file web server. And we're going to do this on our own computer. We'll use that web server to serve files from a particular directory. A folder is often technically called a directory. We'll then see if we can access these files from a browser. And once we set up a basic server on our own computer, we'll see if we can run multiple servers on the same computer. Since I'm going to be running this experiment on my own computer, this is what my stack looks like. My operating system is Mac OS X because my laptop is a MacBook. The web server I'll be using is HTTP Server. HTTP Server is the name of a software package. If you click on the link on the slides, it will take you to the name of that package. I will not be using a database or a programming language for this simple experiment. I do have to install something on my system, which is Node.js. And the reason I have to install this is because HTTP Server, which is the package, the software, it needs the Node.js environment. To be very clear, this is just an example configuration. I can do the exact same experiment with a completely different setup. For example, I can use a different operating system, say Windows or Linux. I can have a completely different web server like Apache or Nginx. A quick exercise for you guys is to think about why I don't need a database or programming language for this simple experiment. Now, during this experiment, you'll see that I use the command line tool or the terminal application quite often. The terminal is something that seems quite scary to a lot of beginners when they start. It kind of reminds you of Matrix with a black screen, a lot of green numbers going up and down. But it's important to understand that the terminal or the command line interface, it is just another interface to do what we normally do with our mouse and keyboard. Let me show you an example of what using the terminal is like. So this is my desktop. As you can see on my desktop, I have three folders and two photographs, right? I can look at these exact same files through a different interface, which is the terminal. I open the terminal application. I'm going to make it a little larger and increase the font size. Okay, so I can go to the desktop by doing cd desktop, which reads change directory desktop. So now I'm in the desktop and I can do an ls. Ls is a command to say list files. So now I've used my keyboard to type the command ls and I see a list of files, and you can see that it's saying that I have three directories which are in a different color and two files which are in a different color, which are PNG files. This is the exact same as looking at the interface here. For example, I can say, so I can see now these files in more detail because I passed a more specific command, and this shows me the same files but what the different sizes are. So this, for example, says that this PNG image is 215,000 bytes. This one is about 215,000 bytes, which is about 212 KB. Now, in case I, for example, create a new folder, right, and I call it folder 1. I can do the same thing from the terminal, mkdir folder 2, and then you can see that folder 2 has appeared. I can double click and see the contents of folder 2. But when I double clicked, the file browser opened up and showed me the contents of the folder. I can do the same thing. I can also open the file browser because the file browser is another program. I can open the file browser from my terminal. So I go inside folder 2 and I say open. And then you can see that the file browser is opened. So this act of me executing this command from here was equivalent to me double clicking on folder 2 and opening the file browser here. Let's say I create a new file. I'll use a text editor called Vim. So I've created a new file in this folder. I go back and I look, and I can see that the file is in this folder. I can double click on this file and edit it from a more friendly text editor, which is an editor like Notepad, which is called Text Edit in Mac. And I can edit the contents and say, this is a new line. And I can save it, I can exit it, and I can continue editing it from the terminal through my terminal text editor. The one that I use is called Vim. And I can see a new line. I can paste it a bunch of times, save it. I can look at the file size. I can look at the file size in a more friendly format. It says it's about 4KB in size. So the terminal is a place where I can browse files and folders. I can execute commands. For example, I can even open up Chrome. And executing this command would be equivalent to clicking on the Chrome browser here and opening it. Now, the terminal software that I used on my Mac to do this is available on other operating systems also. There is something called the command prompt or PowerShell on Windows, which is equivalent to the terminal, which is sort of equivalent to the terminal app on Mac. It's also called shell or terminal on Linux. Now let's move on to actually deploying our web server. So the first thing I need to do is to install Node.js and then install HTTP server. Let's go to these links and see how we do that. So once you go to the Node.js page, it will prompt you for different operating systems, and you can install the right version for your operating system. Once you've installed Node, which I already have, we'll then install HTTP Server. Once you go to the HTTP Server page, you can scroll down, and it'll give you a command for installing HTTP Server globally. Now, this command is a command that you execute on your command line, so I can copy this command, go to my terminal, and paste this command. The next step is to create a directory. So I'm going to make a directory called web. I go inside the web directory. I add content that I want to serve inside that directory. And so I'm going to say, and so my file is added. I'm then going to run HTTP server in this directory. So I type out the command. And now once I run HTTP server, it says serving available on, right? So let's go to our browser and let's go to this URL. I copy it and it shows me my file.txt. And if I click on it, I can now open my file. So we have a web server that's serving our file, right? Let's stop the server. If I press Control C, I can stop the server. And let's add some more files. So let's add an HTML file. Let's start HTTP server again. If I refresh this page, it's still here. If I change this to HTML, I can see my HTML file. The interesting thing to note that when I'm connected to my Wi-Fi network, on my LAN, my IP is this. And so this means that I can also access my server on this IP, right? Is to use the host name localhost. Now I'm getting an error which says the site can't be reached, which is because I've switched my server off. And so I switch it on again, and my server is live. So all of these host names or IPs are in fact pointing to the same server. The next thing that we want to do is create another directory. So let's go back, Control C and stop our server. Let's add another folder, mkdir web2. And in this folder, I'm going to have second.txt. This is the second web server serving a text. file, right? And I'm going to open another instance of the terminal. So you can see that I have two terminals open. I'm going to zoom that a little bit. And so these are two different directories. I'm going to move to desktop and web. So as you can see here, I'm in a directory web, and here I'm on the directory web too. I can run the HTTP server here. Now, if I try to run the HTTP server here, the error thrown is address already in use. So this means that port 8080 is already being used by another server. So I can change the port and use port 8081. Let's now go back and check this out. Let's go to localhost 8081. And you can see second.txt. If you click on second.txt, you'll see a second web server. So simultaneously, we have two servers running on the same IP. And the only way this can happen is because of the concept of ports. Ports allow me to run multiple servers on the same computer. So I just installed Node.js, HTTP server, and then got two web servers running on my computer. It might be hard for you to get this system running on your own computers, because you'll need to be a little familiar with the terminal, which is usually much easier for Linux or Mac users. You'll also have to make sure that Node.js and HTTP server are installed correctly. If you have time, please do try this exercise out. But if you're running out of time and you're not familiar with the system enough, or you're not able to get the installations working correctly, make sure you watch this video carefully and understand what I was doing when I was running the commands and what I was doing when I was accessing the files after creating the web servers. There are a few useful links that I've found that I've mentioned on the slides here that you can try for installing Node.js and NPM and HTTP server on Windows. So let's try to quickly see how what we did fits into our understanding from what we've already understood in the previous modules. We understood that a browser is a web client which makes a request through the network to the computer, to the web server, and the web server responds back on the same connection following the same route. What we did here, however, was that the browser and the server were sitting on the same machine. Our browser made a request, and somehow it went to the web server sitting on our own computer, and the web server responded, and the response came back onto our browser. This is what really happens. When the browser tries to request a server, the browser mentions an IP. The browser sends out the connection via an operating system call. The operating system detects that the IP is not an external IP, but is a special internal IP that belongs to the system itself. And so the operating system loops the request back into the system. Then the port number is used to figure out which process the system needs to request. In our case, we made a request to IP:8080, and so it went to the process that was listening on the port number 8080. The request goes up to the web server, comes back down through the same connection. Similarly, when we made a request to our IP:8081, the connection again looped back, came to the process that was on the port 8081, and hit the web server. These special IPs that redirect back to our own system are 127.0.0.1, localhost is the host name, vcap.me is also a host name that often redirects back to the same system. Your LAN IP will also loop back to your own system. If we go through the steps that we discussed about building a web app, in this case, we've built a very simple web app that just serves files, but this web app cannot be used by other people. Other people can't use our web app that we just made, or this simple file server, because our IP is not a static IP. Our IP is not public to the world. If our IP was public to the world, we could have attached a domain name to our IP, and then people could have used our web app by using that domain name. Because we don't have a static IP, other people can't use our app. But others on our own LAN can use our app because our IP is known to everybody on the same LAN. The second step that we discussed when we wanted to build a web app was to set up a computer with an IP to serve the web app. This process was done because we were using our computer, which had our own IP. We did not have to link the domain name to the server's IP address because we were not using the domain name. In our case, we were using a special host name, which was localhost, and this process is automatically done. The fourth step that we discussed was to write application code or to write a web server, which we did not need to do in this case because HTTP server, the software that we used, automatically serves static files. The fifth step, which was deploying our application code or our web server onto our server host, also need not be done because in our case, our server was our computer. We also discussed how we would write application code to deploy our web server. In this case, we are not writing any application code. We are simply installing a pre-configured web server. We discussed that the steps involved to write application code would be to listen on the network, accept a request, process the request, output a response, and send the response back. We did not have to write any code, and we simply used a pre-configured server because HTTP server, the software, similar to Apache or Nginx, is pre-configured to process requests in a particular way and respond in a particular way. It processes requests by assuming that URL paths are actually file locations, and it responds with the contents of the file that it finds. I did this experiment on my computer, which was running the operating system OS X. I encourage all of you to try this experiment on Windows, Linux, and even Mac. Record videos of how you did this experiment, upload them to YouTube, and post them on the forum so that other people can also learn from these videos. The next week, when we build our web app, we'll directly do it from the browser. You will not need to learn how to use the terminal or install software yourself. When we build a web app, you will not need to buy a domain name because we will have created domain names for each student. You will not need to buy hosting also because we have micro VPS-like hosting for each student. You will also not need to learn how to deploy code using SSH or FTP because we'll automatically copy files for you that you edit, and we'll automatically copy them for you onto your server. You will just write your server and write your web app, and it will automatically work on the domain name that we give to you.